Random House Audio presents Star Wars, Fate of the Jedi, Omen, by Christie Golden. Read for you by Marc Thompson. A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away. Prologue. Orbiting Xyost, 2 standard years ago. Dissian felt the planet even before it appeared on the main bridge monitor of the Poison Moon. She sensed it had seen her, as she now saw it. This seemingly harmless world of blue and white and green. And she smiled gently. The pale geometric tattoos on her face, standing out in stark contrast with her dark skin tones, crinkled with her smile. This was the destination she had beheld in her mind's eye a short while before, the unvoiced answer to the question of what she was hoping to intercept here. She had ordered the crew of this frigate to make all speed and only hoped she was in time.
Where are you going, charming one?
To unopened eyes and dead senses, this planet would seem a world much as any other. A world with oceans and landmasses, heavily, practically entirely forested with 2 white ice-capped poles on either end. White clouds drifted lazily above it. But it was not a world like any other. It was Xyost, homeworld of the Sith. What was left of the Sith Order now remained silent and in hiding on Korriban. She would return there soon, but not without the prize she had come to claim. Dissian realized she was leaning forward slightly in anticipation and settled back in her command chair. She gently pushed her excitement down, lest it interfere with her mission.
Waynus, take us into orbit.
In her role as an intelligence gatherer, the light, musical tone of her voice often deceived others into thinking her much, much more harmless than she was. Her crew knew better.
Yes, Captain.
The chief pilot of the Poison Moon replied. Waynus was a laconic man, not at all force-sensitive, pleased enough to do as he was told in exchange for the generous pay he was receiving. In his own way, the graying ex-pirate was as fair, honorable, and hard-working as many so-called upstanding citizens. He had done well by Dissian on this mission already.
Any sign of the meditation sphere?
She asked Athela, her sensor officer. Athela leaned forward. Her face, which would have been beautiful in the traditional Hapan manner, if not for the horrific burn scar that marred the right side, furrowed in concentration.
Negative,
Athela replied, as Xyost appeared in the forward viewports and the Poison Moon settled into orbit around it.
No indication of it on the planet's surface.
She turned to regard her captain.
Looks like we beat it here.
Dissian smiled again. No mistakes. All that remained was to capture the small vessel itself. Dissian settled in to wait, her dark eyes on the slowly turning planet in front of her. It gazed back at her, and she felt a tug in her heart. She wanted to land the Poison Moon, to walk Xyost's forests as other Sith had done in ages past. But that was not why they were here. She must think of the good of the One, the Order, above her own yearnings. One day, perhaps, she would stand upon the surface of this world, but that day would not be today. They did not have long to wait. Only a few moments later, Athela said,
Picking it up on long-range sensors, Captain.
Dissian sat up straighter in her chair.
You have all served well and brilliantly. Now, as our smuggler pilot might say, it is time to close this deal.
It was time for her, Dissian, to be perfect. She could not afford a mistake now. She felt it even as Athela transmitted the image to her personal view screen. There it was, the Sith meditation sphere. She regarded it for a moment, taking it in. The orange-yellow-red hue, the spherical shape flanked by twin sets of bat-like wings. It resembled an enormous eye.
Hello again, charming one,
she said in her most pleasant voice. Silence from the sphere.
As you see, we have anticipated your arrival. Why have you come to Xyost?
Home.
The voice was inside her head, masculine and intensely focused. A little thrill of exhilaration shivered through Dissian. This was not a pet to be coaxed, but a mount to be broken. It respected strength and will. Dissian had plenty of both.
There is a better place for you than on an abandoned world.
Dissian did not speak the words. Her melodic voice was no asset in this negotiation. The focus and strength of her thoughts were. The vessel continued its approach to Xyost, not wavering in the slightest. But Dissian sensed she had its attention. It would listen.
You are a Sith meditation sphere. Come with me to where the Sith are now. Serve us as you were designed to do.
She let herself visualize Korriban, with not just two Sith, but many who were one. With apprentices in need of focus and training and the power of the dark side, if they were to achieve the glory and power that were rightfully theirs.
It's slowing its approach, Ethela said. It's come to a full halt.
Dissian didn't bother to tell the Haven woman that she already knew that she was intimately connected with this meditation sphere, this ship. It seemed particularly interested in the younglings, and she understood that this had been the focus of its design, to protect and educate apprentices, to prepare them for their destinies.
You will come to Korriban. You will serve me, Dissian. And you will teach the younglings. You will fulfill your intended purpose.
This was the moment upon which everything hinged. She sensed scrutiny from the vessel. Dissian was unashamed of her strengths and let it see her freely. It sensed her will, her drive, her passions, her desire for perfection.
Perfection,
said Ship. It mulled over the word.
Nothing less serves the dark side fully. You will help me to attain perfection for the Sith.
Perfection cannot be obtained by hiding.
Dissian blinked. This had caught her by surprise.
It is wisdom. We will stay isolated, grow strong, and then claim what is ours.
Ship considered. Doubt gnawed at the corner of Dissian's mind like a gizka. She crushed it utterly, ruthlessly, and poured all her will into the demand.
The Jedi grow strong and numerous. It is not time to hide. I will not serve. I will find a better purpose.
She felt it shut down in her mind, close itself off to her in what was tantamount to a dismissal. Dissian felt her cheeks grow hot. How could it have refused?
Captain, said Ethela, the ship has resumed course to Xyost.
I can see that,
Dissian snapped, and Ethela stared openly. Ship was a rapidly disappearing sphere on her screen, and as she watched, it was lost to sight. Dissian returned her attention to her crew, who, she realized, were all looking at her with confused expressions on their faces. She took a deep, steadying breath.
The vessel would not have been appropriate for us, she said, her pleasant voice challenging anyone to disagree. Its programming is antiquated and outdated. Our original message was successful. It is time to pick up the shuttle crews and return home. Plot a course through hyperspace for Omega 379,
she instructed Waynus. He turned around and his fingers flew lightly over the console. The Poison Moon's original mission had not been to recover ship, as Dissian had begun thinking of the sphere. Dissian had initially been sent to track down a Twi'lek woman named Alima Rar and her base of operations. Rar had somehow inherited a lost force technique that enabled her to project phantoms across space. Dissian had been ordered to destroy both the woman and the dark side energy source, lest either fall into Jedi hands. And then she had been forced to choose between two unexpected prizes. When the Poison Moon arrived at Alimarar's base, coming in stealthed, Dissian had discovered they were not alone. One of the two vessels already at the asteroid was none other than the Millennium Falcon. Subsequent observations of her operations revealed that it was more than likely her notorious owner, Han Solo.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.